Good morning.
Today is Transfiguration Sunday, the last Sunday of the Epiphany season. We began Epiphany with white, turned to green all season, and now we're back to white. It's a celebration day. Our Lord's glory revealed on that high and holy mountain. So we begin our worship this morning. We invite you to greet those around you. The peace of the Lord. Sunday is spoken of sometimes as the Sunday when we bury the Alleluias, or use them all up, because we don't sing Alleluias during the season of Lent. To make use of our last chance to sing some Alleluias, we join in hymn 821.
Thank you.
151, Divine Service, Setting 1. As you're able, please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Then confess our sins to God, our Father. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean.
We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite you to take out the insert from your bulletin for the Transfiguration of our Lord. We join in the words of the intro. Exalt the Lord our God,
and worship at his holy mountain. For the Lord our God is holy. The Lord reigns above the people's tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name.
Peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. And for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Thank you.
be with you. Let us pray. O God, in the glorious transfiguration of your beloved Son, you confirm the mysteries of the faith by the testimony of Moses and Elijah. In the voice that came from the bright cloud, you wonderfully foreshadow our adoption by grace. Mercifully make us co-heirs with the King in his glory, and bring us to the fullness of our inheritance in heaven, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament reading for the transfiguration of our Lord comes from 2 Kings chapter 2. In these verses, we see how Elijah is miraculously taken up to heaven. And he will be seen again in our gospel reading, the Mount of Transfiguration. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elisha, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel, and the sons of the prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he said, "Yes, I know it. Keep quiet." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The sons of the prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know it. Keep quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the sons of the prophets also went and stood at some distance from them as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his cloak and rolled it up and struck the water, and the water was parted to the one side and to the other, till the two of them could go over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Ask what I shall do for you before I am taken from you." And Elisha said, "Please, let there be a double portion of your spirit on me." And he said, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken from you, it shall be so for you. But if you do not see me, it shall not be so." And as they still went on and talked, behold, chariots of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elisha went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it. And he cried, my father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." And he saw him no more. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And led them up a high mountain by themselves, and
He was transfigured before them, and his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah." For he did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And a cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." And suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, he charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord. We continue with our sermon here. Grace and mercy and peace to each of you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Last night we had a baptism, and there was a huge extended family. Not just the parents and their siblings, but the grandparents, and I think most of the great-grandparents were still living as well. And so people were coming up to me before church and introducing themselves and saying, "I'm the great-grandparent, I'm the grandfather," whatever it might be. All of them telling me their connection to the little baby who was going to be baptized. There was some pride in their voices about this newest member to the family and about their connection to this little baby. Reminded me a bit of the words in our gospel where God the Father says the same thing. "This is my beloved son." There is pride and ownership and a claiming and a relationship as the Father speaks. Today is one of the great festivals of the church year, the Transfiguration of our Lord. It doesn't get the same play as Christmas or Easter, and perhaps rightly so, but it's a white Sunday, a celebration Sunday. We began the Epiphany season that first Sunday, hearing the voice of the Heavenly Father again, that time at Jesus' baptism, saying, "You, Jesus, are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." And today we've heard the Father's voice again proclaim the same thing. "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." And in these Sundays in between, in the season of Epiphany, we've seen Jesus revealed by his miracles, by his words and deeds, to be the very Son of God, the Messiah, the Savior of the world. Today is a high point in the church year. Following today, we head to Lent quickly, as Jesus himself points us as he walks down the mountain with his disciples and speaks of what lies ahead for him. Our text begins with these three words, "after 6 days." Mark says those words because something important happened 6 days earlier. Not just any event, but perhaps the high point or the center point of Jesus' teaching. This week from 6 days earlier to today is central in Jesus' ministry. Jesus, 6 days earlier, had asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And the disciples say, "Well, some people think you're Elijah." That Elijah, who had gone up to heaven in that fiery chariot and whirlwind, had come back as the prophets had proclaimed. Or maybe this guy, the people said, he's another prophet. Moses had proclaimed a prophet who would come, who would be great as he was. And this one might fit that bill. Moses, come back. But then Jesus asked his disciples, "And you, what do you say? Who do you think I am?" And Peter responds with that great, bold confession of faith, "You are the Christ. You are the Messiah, the anointed one, the promised one, the fulfiller of prophecy." Peter aced that test question, got it perfectly right. Jesus has been spending almost 2 years trying to get his disciples to understand who he is, that he is the Messiah. And now it's clear. Peter at least gets it, and probably the rest of the disciples as well. And Jesus says, "Blessed are you, Simon," which was still his name, "but from now on you will be called Peter. And on this rock of your confession, I will build my church." And 6 days prior to our text that same day, then Jesus begins to talk to his disciples about what it means They've gotten the first half of his message that he is the Messiah. Now they need to learn the second half, the second truth, what it means that Jesus is the Messiah, that he has come to suffer and die. And when he begins to speak these words, Peter blurts out, "No way, Jesus, never." And Peter flunks that question on the test. Jesus, in fact, responds, "Get behind me, Satan. You are thinking in human ways, not God's ways." Jesus is saying, "I've come to be a far greater Messiah than you can imagine. Not simply to take care of the Romans, but to take care of a greater enemy, Satan himself, and the sins that weigh you down, the sins that would take you to hell. I've come to rescue you." And in this messiahship, there will be a cross for me, but also a cross for you as my disciples. It's a lesson the disciples won't actually get or actually learn until they see Jesus on the cross and then risen from the dead and then empowered by the Holy Spirit. They'll be able to proclaim and to understand and to teach that truth. But here in our text, we are 6 days after that central and important event. And it is paired with this important event. Jesus takes his inner three, Peter, James, John, up a high mountain. The disciples are probably thinking they are going there for another time of prayer. That's what usually happened when Jesus took his disciples to a desolate place. But Jesus this time has a different kind of time with God planned out. His transfiguration. Suddenly the veil that has hidden Jesus' divine glory is removed. His human body, his earthly skin, no longer contains all the glory of God, but it shines right through his skin. The disciples see that glory. Even his clothes are dazzling white like nothing they've seen. The veil is removed. The disciples see a light, a brightness, a glory that almost kills them. So holy is it. Pure holiness. And Elijah and Moses standing next to Jesus, proof that the people 6 days earlier were wrong. This rabbi of theirs is not Elijah or Moses. No, Elijah and Moses stand in testimony to Jesus, the greater one, the Messiah. And the reaction of the disciples is fear, terror. Not just that it was a strange and unexpected sight, that the light was so bright, but spiritual terror. For a sinner to stand in the glory and holiness of God is a terrifying thing. Our spiritual nakedness is revealed. Our helplessness, weakness, hopelessness before God. Jesus, in his glory and holiness, reveals the darkness of sin, the depravity of sin. The disciples' sin is evident to them. Our sin becomes evident to us. as we stand in the holiness of Jesus. God, of course, always knows our sin. But in the bright light of God's law, we see our sin. We recognize it. We know it well. We're led to say, "Woe is me. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy." We cannot hide or cover up our sin. The only thing we can do is confess it. Admit it. Own up to it. It's mine. Lord, I am a sinner. And then flee to the mercy of Jesus. Have mercy on my soul. Have mercy on me. And Jesus does. He's come and brought his disciples to that Mount of Transfiguration, not just that they could see how holy Jesus is, not just that they could see how bad their sin is, but most of all, that they could be pointed to the cross, that they could be pointed to that which would take away their sins, that which would take away our sins. God doesn't point out our sins just to make fun of us or to show us how bad we are. No, our sins are revealed so that we might get rid of them, that we might receive and know that we need exactly what the cross of Jesus offers. Next in our text is a cloud, often the sign of God's presence. The cloud that led the children of Israel, the cloud on the top of Mount Sinai, the cloud that filled the temple. And a voice comes from the cloud, the voice of the Father, "This is my beloved Son," echoing the words of Jesus' baptism. But at the baptism, the Father was speaking to Jesus, "You are my beloved Son." But now he's speaking to the disciples, saying, "This one, he, Jesus, my Son, the one I love." In a sense, the Father is answering Jesus' question of 6 days earlier. "Who do you say that I am?" The Father chimes in, This is my beloved Son, the one I have sent to fulfill the law and the prophets, the greater Moses and Elijah, the one they prophesied and promised and testified to. My Son, who has come to fulfill those prophecies, the prophecy to Adam to crush the head of the evil one, the prophecy to Abraham to bless all the nations, the prophecy to David to have a king and son who will reign forever, the prophecy to Isaiah of a suffering servant whose stripes and wounds will make us whole. That's Jesus. This one, my beloved Son, he is the Messiah, the Christ, the promised and anointed one. He is the Savior of the world. Yes, the Father says, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him. Hear his word. Receive his word that it may make you whole." My friends, in your sin, hear his voice that says to you, "You are forgiven." In your fear and despair, Jesus says to you, "You are loved." In your baptism, as he did in Mallory's last night, he says, "You are mine. You are my child. I have come to take your place to take your sin, to heal and restore you. You need not fear my holiness, for I have come to make you like me, Jesus says, holy, pure, filled with the glory of God, ready for heaven. My friends, listen to this voice of Jesus as he speaks to you in his word and his sacraments. And then finally, our text says they no longer saw anyone but Jesus only. The terror was gone. They have the comfort of Jesus' presence. They go down the mountain. Don't tell anyone, he says. It'll be too hard to understand. Not until the Son of Man dies and rises again. Not until Good Friday and Easter. Then it will be clear. Death is coming, but so is life. Jesus will be risen from the dead. Yes, we enter into Lent, but Easter also is coming soon. Death will be defeated, Satan vanquished. Victory to Jesus, victory to us, Jesus only. This is my beloved Son. This is our beloved, beautiful Savior. He takes our fear, our terror, our sin, that we may one day shine and reign with him in glory, that the Father may say to you, you are my beloved child, my son, my daughter. All of this thanks to Jesus. Jesus only, our beautiful Savior. And that, my friends, is the way that it is on this transfiguration of our Lord in the year of our Lord 2018. We join now in our next hymn, hymn 414. Page 159, in response to our God and his word, we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. Please rise.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
May be seated. We bring our offerings to the Lord at this time. Also, please sign the friendship register, the red folder in your pew, and pass it to those who are seated next to you. Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. We rise for prayer. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the ways that you reveal Jesus to be your Son and our Savior. For your voice at his baptism and on the holy mountain, for the glory that shone there, for his words and miracles, we pray that all people might see and know that Jesus is the Savior, the only Savior of all the world, that all people might know and trust in him. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, on days when we are discouraged, lonely, sad, confused, mourning, we pray that we might hear your voice speak to us, that we might hear and know that we are your beloved children, that you have claimed us and called us and love us so deeply. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, as we enter now into the season of Lent, we pray that you would bless our hearts, our minds, our faith, as we gather to hear your word and to reflect upon the love and the suffering and death of your Son on our behalf. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the gift of life that you have given to Kyle and Megan in the birth of Sawyer Roy. We pray for your health and safety for them, and especially that you would give them joy as their son comes into your kingdom in the waters of baptism. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, you give the gift of marriage. We give you thanks for Delbert and Linda, for the 50 years of marriage that you have blessed them with. And we pray that you would continue to bless them and every marriage, that it might be filled with your love and presence and joy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, we pray for those who are ill, for those who are suffering, for those for whom death may draw near. We pray, O Lord, that it might be your will to grant your healing to Benny, Isaac, Werner, Linda, Dan, Elaine, to Jerry, Lois, to Arlo, to Bob, Corey, Lori, Mike, Colleen, Char, Joanne, Ray, Steve, to Lester, Dave, Sally, Aiden, Mary, Jackie, Jan, and all in any need. Above all, may they know your love, your presence. May they be comforted and strengthened by your words and promises. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.
Thank you.
Special welcome to our guests today. Good to have you here. Special thanks to all of our musicians, band instrumentalists, and pianists, organists. Arlo, we appreciate the sharing of your gifts and talents. Everyone's invited downstairs for coffee. Following that, for Sunday school and Bible class. Also this afternoon, Delbert and Linda's 50th anniversary is here at the fellowship hall. On Tuesday of this week, we're starting an adult confirmation class. If you know somebody who might be interested, let them know or let me know. But that'll be on Tuesdays for the next few weeks. Wednesday then begins Lent, Ash Wednesday, 7:30. We'll be focusing on parables that apply to Lent this year. There's a flyer in your bulletin. You might take that to invite somebody else to come with you. We'll have imposition of ashes on Wednesday. All of our Wednesday services also will be preceded by soup suppers at 6:30. And again, anyone is welcome to those. There is also in your bulletin a flyer on the men's retreat at Lutheran Island Camp next week. It's a great retreat, and they have a really great speaker this year. So if you're free next weekend, well worth going to Lutheran Island Camp for that. Pray the Lord be with each of you this coming week and keep you in his care and love.